Well, good morning, Broadway. How's everybody this morning? We good? It's finally nice weather. I'm like a different person, I think. It's amazing. Well, hey, as you guys heard last week, we are starting a new sermon series called Grace Bomb. Everybody say Grace Bomb. Grace Bomb, thank you. And in this series, we're actually going to be highlighting some of our ministry partners. What is a ministry partner, you ask? We have several things that we partner with and reach out to both locally and internationally. And so we're going to be highlighting kind of some of those. We've got some really, really fun videos from people of varying quality, perhaps, but they're incredible. This first one is from Lexington Rescue Mission. And why don't you guys tune into this video to hear more about him?
Rescue Mission, and I just want to extend a heartfelt thank you to all of you at Broadway Christian Church. You all have been an invaluable partner from the very beginning of the mission's history. 23 years ago, my dad moved to Lexington to start the Lexington Rescue Mission, and one of the very first people he met was Jim Bird, who became one of his very first board members. And because of the partnership we had with Broadway Christian Church, our very first service was a Thanksgiving dinner there in your fellowship hall, which we've continued to have every year. All of our Thanksgiving dinners, many of our Christmas dinners, have been hosted at Broadway Christian Church. And for many people, that's the very first encounter that they have with the Lexington Rescue Mission. Over the years, your partnership has grown and we have strengthened and deepened it, where today there are so many ways that you all invest in the ministry of the mission and where we get to partner in this kingdom work. Our residents come to Broadway Christian Church for church and Sunday school. They grow in their faith and their relationship with Jesus. Many of them have been baptized at the church recently over the last few years and have become an invaluable part of the church. We also have helped with the Celebrate Recovery ministry at the church, which has deepened people's faith and relationships in so many ways and strengthened their recovery. And today, we continue to work with Broadway Christian in partnership to address the deepest needs of the city. And we're excited now with our new building to be just down the street and to be able to partner in so many more ways. So from the bottom of my heart, thank you guys for all you do. You support this mission in so many ways, and I'm so thankful for all your contributions. God bless.
Amen. So now what I'm going to ask is that if you were involved in Lexington Rescue Mission, would you stand for our church to recognize you and so that we can pray for you at this time? Yeah, Lee and Beth, yeah, Taylor. If you guys feel comfortable, would you lay hands on them as we pray together? Oh, sorry, go ahead. Everyone should stand up, is what Lisa said. I love it. Yeah, because we have, oh, all residents stand up. Yeah, absolutely. Let's give it up for them as well. If you feel comfortable, would you lay hands on these people as we pray for them? Father, we are so thankful for what you've done through Lexington Rescue Mission. It's amazing, Lord, that you've created belonging, created a place for people who may have been on the worst of their luck to receive love and encouragement. And Father, in the same, as Broadway's reached out to them and supported them, Father, they have blessed us so much. The way they worship, the way they have meaningful conversations, the way they love has just encouraged me specifically on staff, but has encouraged every single one of us. And Father, I pray that you continue to do a wonder and a work inside of Lexington Rescue Mission for these residents, for the staff, for the directors that are here. I pray that you continue to give them just clairvoyance when it comes to what your next step is for them. And Father, would you teach us in this next season what it means to continue to participate in what you're doing in Lexington and in Central Kentucky? We pray these things, Lord, in your son's name. Amen. Let's give it up for Lexington Rescue one more time. We've got a couple more announcements for you. First of all, my name is Logan, and I'm one of the worship pastors here. Thank you so much for joining us this morning as we kind of come post-Easter and have the beautiful spring weather. We're so excited to have you guys here this morning. First thing is, you guys may have seen, because of the tornadoes, we actually moved Martha Circle's meeting from last Tuesday, where they weren't whisked away in the parking lot, to this Tuesday, the 9th. So if you previously signed up there, you can obviously come this time. If you have any questions, Michelle Wagner's information is on the screen, mewagner@hotmail.com. She'd love to talk to you more about that. Secondly, again, if you're new here, we've got a couple things we'd love you to do. First of all, there is a card in the seat in front of you that if you fill that out and give it to our host stand, Addie will be out there. She's waving in the back. She would love to give you a free gift and to meet you and get to know you. There's also a QR code on the screen that will link to our website in which you can connect with us, and one of our pastors will get in touch with you later on this week. And we just love to meet you. Love to get to know more about you. So I think that's all we have for announcements. If you guys would stand, we're going to continue worship or begin worship this morning.
Oh, Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names.
Oh, death cannot hold you.
Yeah.
Let me pray for us. Father, we are so thankful for all these words that we can use to describe you, Lord, that don't even scratch the surface of who you are. Father, in Job, your word says that we only know the outskirts of your ways, just a whisper of who you are. And Father, we feel that this morning. Let those words not just be lyrics on a projector, but the anthem of our heart this morning, Lord, that you are powerful. You are all-knowing. You are beyond what our hearts could even hope for or imagine in a loving Father. And yet you choose to care for us, Lord, in ways that confound us. Father, I pray that our hearts are ready to receive what you have for us this morning, that we're not just listening for what man can bring, but we're listening by your Spirit to what you say to us this morning. Father, we pray these things in your Son's name. Church, if you would take a seat together, we're going to shift into our communion time. And if you didn't get one of those emblems, they are around tables. I'm sure a lot of our section hosts would love to bring those to you or grab those for you if you don't have those. But during this time, we just ask that you take a moment to reflect on these two emblems. One is the bread that represents his body that was broken for us. And the second is the fruit of the vine that represents his blood that was shed. I think every year around Easter, this becomes even more poignant to me, that this is not a meal for our stomachs as much as it is a meal for our minds. And in this moment, you may take time to pray to God. You may take time to read through scriptures, especially in the Gospels, that outline who this God is, that loves in this way. You may take time to journal and think about what God is pressing upon your heart at this time, but we ask that whatever you do over the next few minutes, that you do so in a manner that is worthy of the meal that we're sharing together for God, who willingly gave his life for each and every one of us. So take a few minutes.
3 weeks ago, I attended a conference with our church staff in Indianapolis, Indiana. And when you go to these conferences, different things stand out to different people. And everyone walks away with something that resonates specifically with them. For me this time, I listened as my friend Jason French spoke. Jason is the president of CIY, which is Christ in Youth, a nationwide organization that empowers young people to live their lives for Christ. And he called out the church, the Big C Church. And he stepped on our toes, and he was right to do so. He said that the church has stopped activating its people and has settled for attendance to be a good measurable for success. See, as long as people show up on Sunday and the room is full, we look at it, we measure that, we pat ourselves on the back, and we say, good job. But Jason challenged us to really look at the call of the church. It's not about attendance. I mean, healthy things grow, and people coming can be an indicator that God is doing something really cool. But if we're just satisfied with people just showing up, there's a serious problem and misunderstanding for what the church was designed for. We see very clearly in Scripture that the church was never designed to be a spectator sport. It's not about people, it's not about getting people to come. It's actually about getting people to go. Amen. What I learned from Jason 3 weeks ago is something I should have known already, and maybe that I did. And so it was really a reminder, but man, it resonated with me, and it really hit home, and it brought it to the forefront of my mind. Friends, the church was designed for activation, not attendance. See, activation is greater than attendance. See, things are designed with a purpose. I mean, take cars, for instance. Different kind of cars for different purposes. Lamborghinis are manufactured for speed and possibly status. Those are its purposes, right? Contrast the minivan, you know, built for families to get groceries and to get kids to and from soccer practice, right? Or the Ford F-150. It's built for hauling and towing. Folks, Christians were also built with a purpose. On one hand, we were built to be in a right relationship with our Creator. We were grace-built. Now, grace-built is not a term you're going to find in the Bible, but you see it take shape in Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, especially in Ephesians chapter 2, 8 and 9. He writes this. He says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It's a gift from God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." So first of all, we are a product of grace. We didn't deserve it. We didn't earn it. We can't boast and say, look how I worked my way into heaven. Look how I earned my way into heaven, okay? It had to be given to us. Someone had to grace bomb us. On the other hand, when it comes to other people, it's multifaceted and it's dynamic. But one thing is clear, we were created to grace bomb others with the grace that we were bombed with. And then listen to verse 10. "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." So I want to unpack that verse for just a second, verse 10. We are his workmanship. Workmanship literally means a thing of his making. He built us. We were made by his own hand, crafted like a masterpiece. Psalm 139, 13 through 14 says this, "You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made." God knit you together when you were in your mother's womb. You ever watch someone knit? Maybe your grandmother knitted an afghan or a quilt. I mean, it's tedious, it's meticulous, and it's intentional. I couldn't do it. I just can't sit that long. But God did. He took time to make you. Eye color, personality, intellect, talents, gifts, temperament, fingerprints, knitted you together. Then comes the purpose in verse 10. Created in Christ Jesus for what? Good works. Created in Christ Jesus for good works. Now, I think there's two main big reasons that God created us. First, he created people so that he could give love and he could be the reciprocate of that love. But then second, he built them for the purpose of sharing love with other people. People were built to love God and love each other. In fact, when Jesus was asked about what's the greatest commandment ever, he answered this way in Matthew chapter 27 through 39. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And then he voluntarily gave the second. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor the same way you love yourself. Love God, love people. So when God created people, he gave them good works to do so that they might not only experience his goodness, but also reflect his goodness in the way they care for each other. In other words, we are grace-built people meant to grace other people. We were created to do good works. In fact, James the Just, the half-brother of Jesus, went as far as to say this in James chapter 2, verses 14 through 17. He said this, "What good is it, brothers, if someone says he has faith, but he doesn't have any works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warm and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, it's dead." So James's statement calls into question, if we aren't doing good works, were we saved at all? Were we changed at all? Or did we just go down into the water, a dry center, and come up a wet one? See, without an obvious change in our lives where it's evident that we love God and that we love people, are we even Christians? We are grace-built people meant to grace other people. Back into Ephesians 2:10, which God prepared beforehand. So he knew. He built us to do it. He knew it. And in fact, he designed us for that purpose. He gave us just the right gifting to make the difference where he wanted the difference to be made. That we should walk in them. That we should walk in good works. Good works is the way that we should roll. Ephesians 2 is not the only place in the Bible that talks about grace bombing other people with good works. 2 Corinthians 9:8 says this, "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work." Colossians 1:10, "So as we walk in the manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God." Titus 2:14, "Who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works." Hebrews 13:16, "Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God." 1 Peter 2:12 says, "Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." Activation is greater than attendance. You know, every morning all around our planet, the sun rises and it casts its light and its warmth. And it blows my mind to think that about 8 minutes ago, protons blasted out of the sun, flew through space at the speed of light, and arrived here at this moment so that we can see outside. And our sun is just but one of billions and billions. Jesus said one time in John 8, chapter 12, he said, "I am the light of the world, and whoever follows me will not walk in darkness." I mean, if you think about it, that's a bold claim. He claimed to be the true source of light itself. But what's even more amazing is that he also called us to be the light of the world. Matthew 5, 14 through 16, he said this, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill can't be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and then put it under a basket. No, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to all the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who's in heaven." See, light gives hope. Light points to Jesus. That's us. That's what we're supposed to do. That's who we're supposed to be. That's what we were created for. I remember growing up, what we called junior church back then in children's ministry, you know, and they taught us a little song, and it went like this. You're about to discover why I'm not the worship leader. "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine." And we hold up our little fingers because that was our little light, because they wouldn't give us candles in junior church. But "this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Hide it under a bushel. I'm going to let it." See, you know this. "Hide it under a bushel. I'm going to let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Won't let Satan it out. I'm going to let it shine. Don't let Satan it out. I'm going to let it shine, let it shine, let it shine." But how many of us have hit our lights? How many of us have let Satan come in and blow out our lights? Jesus calls his followers the light of the world. When we become a Christian, inside of us, an eternal flame is lit, and it's his spirit. We call it the Holy Spirit. And his light should blast out from us, and like the sun, that light should bring warmth and light. So when you intentionally love someone, that person will know it, and they will see it, and they will feel it. Never forget stopping at a Waffle House on the way back from vacation one year. The kids were in high school at the time. And as we sat down, it became very apparent that things were not going well with the employees there at the Waffle House. The waitress was curt, even rude, and you could tell there was some major beef between her and the gruff old man who was apparently her boss behind the counter. The kids were so turned off, they said, "Dad, if I were you, I wouldn't leave her a tip. She's mean." But I heard another voice. A voice from that little light inside of me say something very different that afternoon. And now, in full transparency, I don't always listen. And there have been numerous times when I have hidden my light or I've let Satan snuff it out. But for some reason, on this occasion, I listened. And when it came time to pay, I made sure the bill was paid in full, and then I gave her a $100 tip. On top of that, and I don't know what I expected, maybe a smile or maybe what or wow or thank you very much. What I wasn't expecting was the silence. And then the tears. And then she quietly muttered, "But I treated you so badly. I just said, you know, Jesus loves you." Came to find out that she had had some major issues going on in her life in addition to the jerk of a boss. But that little light That one little grace bomb, that one thing, it did something for her. That grace bomb had an impact on her. Sometimes, being a light means loving on someone who at the moment is difficult to love. But when your light shines, man, it will feel good to your neighbor. Did she deserve a big tip? No. She didn't. Absolutely not. But did she get one? Sure did. That's what made it a grace bomb. Activation is greater than attendance. You know, without the light, we would live in an existence of total darkness. Constantly searching, constantly trying to feel our way through. The light is what shows us what's really there. The good works that we are called to do for our neighbors are lights that point them to Jesus. Don't miss the ultimate reason for becoming a grace bomber. The end game of grace bombing is to ultimately introduce people to Jesus, the true light of the world. And it's really intentional. It's more than a random act of kindness. Jesus clearly commanded us to love our neighbors. So a grace bomb is an intentional act of love motivated by Jesus. A grace bomb is an intentional act of love motivated by Jesus. So it's different from a random act of kindness. In fact, it's not random at all. It's intentional. It's even sometimes premeditated. It's when you see something that stirs your passion and motivates you to plan something out and do something about it. That just doesn't mean it can't be fast or spur of the moment. The Spirit might move in you quickly, but it's just not random. It's an intentional act of love motivated by Jesus. Again, listen to Ephesians 2:10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand. God prepared it beforehand. God prepared before. He knew he was going to call you to do it. It might seem spur of the moment for you. It might seem random to you, but it's not. He planned it. Acts 17:26 says this, From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history. In the boundaries of their lands. He marked out their appointed times. I believe that God knows where every person is all the time. And he can see the potential ways that your particular light might impact them, even if you don't. So here's what I want to challenge you to do. I want you to start listening to your nudges. I want you to start listening to your nudges. See, I think it's all about the nudge. I remember as the late 1980s, I was in college, when the original Nintendo game console came out. You know, everybody have this one? Yeah. Anybody still have it? Hardcore. All right, there you go. All right. You know, and Super Mario was like blowing everybody's mind, but right behind Super Mario came Duck Hunt. Remember Duck Hunt, you know? You plugged in the gun, which tended to be kind of glitchy, you know, and you stood in front of your TV, and you waited for those little ducks to fly out, you know, and they would come out of the bush, and you'd be like, boom, 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 you know, you'd shoot the ducks, and you would watch them fall out of the sky, and the little dog would catch them for you or laugh at you if you missed. Remember that? He'd kind of laugh at you. And I even held the gun sideways for a little gangster style points, you know. But the key to Duck Hunt was to be ready, to be aware, to be prepared to shoot. And before the ducks would fly out, a rustling in the bushes alerted you to the coming opportunity. And if you looked for the stirring, you were prepared when the ducks popped out. The bushes provided a nudge to get ready. I believe that God also gives us a nudge, a subtle stirring in the bushes of our spirits that alerts us to opportunities that he's placed along the path of our everyday lives. It's a prompting of the Holy Spirit that points us to how he wants us to grace bomb our neighbors. You might call it listening to a still small voice. I might call it a nudge. And it might happen when something about your neighbor stands out to you. It might happen, it might be just a thought that just warms your heart. It might be a great idea that pops into your head, or an immediate way that it occurs to you that you could put a smile on someone's face. Now, for me, I've never had an audible voice, you know. Nothing's ever called down from heaven, Scott, I want you to go build an ark. Or, I mean, nothing like that, okay? But I don't think it's like Spider-Man who gets like the tingling. He senses there's oncoming danger, okay? But I don't think it's like that. But as grace-built people, we have been endowed by the Holy Spirit of God. And when we start following that Spirit's promptings, his nudges, I believe it will become very clear when he wants to let us shine our lights with a grace bomb. When he wants us to make a difference. When he wants us to love on someone else. When you listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit, I believe wholeheartedly he will put in front of you the opportunity to grace bomb someone else. Activation is greater than attendance. And I know it might be easier to grace bomb someone on the fringes of your life that you'll never see again. And it might be much harder to ask God how to grace bomb the people that are in your close circles, those at work, those across the aisle, those in your family. But here's my challenge, church. And it's twofold. You ready? Here's the first fold. I want to challenge you to dive in with our Broadway community, and together on May 18th, that's a Saturday, we're going to have a serve day here at Broadway. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to pull your phones out right now. Pull your cell phones out. I want you to use your calendar app. I want you to go to May 18th, and I want you to jot down on there from about 8 to 1 o'clock, serve day at Broadway. Go ahead and put that on there. We're going to meet here at 8 a.m. for a small breakfast. We'll pray together, and we're going to go out and serve from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. My goal is to have 100 people from our church show up and serve on serve day. I've contacted a lot of our local missions, and some of our widows have been contacted, and there are things to do here at the church as well. But let me tell you about some of these things on serve day. The Lexington Rescue Mission, you heard from Laura Carr at the beginning of the service, they could use 20 to 30 of our people to go down the street, it's just down at the other end of 2nd Street, organize and sort donations at their new building. They need help making resource packets for clients, cleaning up around the building, moving furniture for clients, possibly even some construction and painting in the new building. They could use that. Harrison Elementary, it's one block behind us. They could use 10 people to help with landscaping in front of the school. Natalie's Sisters, it's over on Lime Street. And they could use 4 to 6 people over there to help with interior cleaning and exterior yard work. Refuge for Women, believe it or not, they would like 5 to 10 people to help them build a dog park. A lot of their clients now have emotional support dogs, and they need a dog park. We need people to do that. Assurance, Crisis Pregnancy Center, they need 4 or 5 people to come down and help them retile the ceiling, put in new tiles. Bluegrass Christian Camp, they need 5 or 6 guys who know how to operate chainsaws and maybe bring a couple chainsaws with them to cut up some down trees to get ready for summer camp where all the kids are going to come this summer. Sayre Christian Village has 4 courtyards that needed their furniture painted. Doug Pyatt, our executive pastor here at Broadway, he needs 5 or 10 people to clean, carry things to the dumpster, maybe do some light painting around the church here. And several of our widows in this congregation need help with various projects. I know Karen Combs needs to get some stuff out of her attic now from underneath her house, needs help with some dead shrubs that need to be dug up. Jackie Ginter needs some boards nailed down on her deck, needs to stain wood on a screen porch. Iron rail on her front porch is loose. It needs to be fixed. Sink handles need fixed. Just little things around the house. Kathy White needs her gutters and downspouts cleaned. Carolyn Colliver needs help replacing ceiling light bulbs and checking smoke alarms. Becky Mancari needs a refrigerator moved out of her garage and taken to the junkyard. Edna Turner needs some laminate laid in one room. Martha McKenzie needs about four pieces of sod laid in her backyard and needs some light bulbs replaced that require someone to stand on a ladder. I mean, family, there are plenty of targets to grace bomb. And so we're going to do that collectively as a church on May 18th. We're going to meet here, we're going to pray, and then we're going to go out to these different assignments, and we're going to love on people. And I need you to sign up, because I need to know who's going where. And so out in the lobby today, Megan will be out there, and there'll be a table as you exit the doors, and there's all kinds of little places that you can sign up, say, hey, I want to do this project, I want to do that project, I want to, and get your names down. Goal is to have 100 people here on May 18th to go out and serve. The second fold, that was fold one. The second fold is personal. It's for you. Here's my challenge in your personal life. I want you to do these things. Step one, I want you to pray. I want you to pray that God would intentionally put someone in your life to grace bomb. And if words are needed, I want you to pray that the Spirit would give you the right words to say in the right way at the right time. And it may be someone close to you, maybe someone across the aisle this morning. I don't know. It might be someone you never met. And then, step two, I want you to load. Stop at the kiosk. That's the rounded desk out there in the lobby. And I want you to pick up at least one grace bomb card. They look like this. Got a little bomb on it. Isn't that cute? And on the back, it says, you've been grace bombed. And it has Broadway's website on it. Step three, I want you to look and listen. Prayerfully look and listen for opportunities that the Spirit will put something in your everyday life to bless someone around you. And then step four, I want you to let her go. Take the next right step of faith in giving your time or your treasure or your talent with a grace bomb card and surprise someone that the Spirit has identified for you to love. And then step five, let us know. I want to know the story. I want to know what happened. You know, tell us, what did God's Spirit lead you to do? What happened? How did you feel? How did they react? You can email me your story just at scott@broadwaychristian.com. I just want to know what you did. I want to hear. I don't know if it's good. I might put it in a sermon, you know? But I want to hear what you've done. Folks, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 says this. And let us consider how to stir up one another. That means we're not going to stay comfortable. We're going to stir it up. How to stir up one another to love and good works. Activation is greater than attendance. Would you pray with me? God, I pray that Broadway Christian Church is not a spectator church where we join the team and sit on the bench and never get in the game. God, I pray that we're not sitting a bench once a week for an hour here on Sunday and we walk out and pat ourselves on the back and say, good job. God, I pray that we would activate our faith, that we would love you with all of our soul and all of our heart, all of our mind, all of our strength, but also that we would love others the same way we love ourselves. God, I pray that people would sign up for May 18th and that they would come ready to grace bomb the community. But God, also, that they would stop at the kiosk and pick up at least one grace bomb card where they could go out and think of someone they can personally love on with a grace bomb. God, we love you. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to go into our response time this morning. There's several things that you can do. Number one, if you have a prayer request and you'd like for the staff to pray for it this week, over there is a lit up board. You can go over and write it down on a post-it note, stick it on that board, and we will pray for that throughout the week, this week. Secondly, if you just want to pray with someone around the room, there will be people that have lanyards on. You can walk up to one of them. They would be happy to pray with you about anything going on in your life. They would love to do it. Next, if you want to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I'm going to be standing over there by the baptistry, and we can make that happen today. And you can be buried in baptism and resurrected a brand new person and begin your life with Christ. And another way to activate is you can activate your generosity. Would you read the screen with me this morning? Holy Father, there is nothing that I have that you have not given me. All I have and am belongs to you, bought with the blood of Jesus. To spend everything on myself and to give without sacrifice is the way of the world that you cannot abide. I am determined to increase in generosity until it can be said that there is no needy person among us. I am determined to be trustworthy with such a little thing as money that you may trust me with true riches.
Stand and worship with us when you're ready.
Into the Jesus Christ, the King above all. be long. The war will be over, and every tear he'll wipe away will be ours. The war will be over, soon we will meet our Savior face to face.
Thank you.
as we watch and wait, like a bride for groom, old church arise, he's coming soon.
Well, church, we've got a baptism to celebrate this morning. If you would take a seat.
Mike Sizemore, and Mike and I have known each other for about a year now, maybe a little more, and he's just gotten to that point where he's like, hey man, I'm ready to fully give myself to Christ, and so we're going to experience his death, his burial, and his resurrection today. So Mike, I'm going to ask you to repeat after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the Living God, and I want to take him as my Lord
and as my Savior.
Mike Sizemore, in obedience to Jesus Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit in death, in burial, in resurrection. Congratulations, buddy.
Church. Thanks so much for being here this morning. We'll see you back next week as we continue our sermon series called Grace Bomb. Have a good week.